Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. In this video, we're going to address specimen collection from special populations. And so we're going to cover pediatric patients in this video and geriatric patients in our next video. So some physiologic considerations for pediatric patients. So these patients can present both atechnical and psychological challenges. It does take expertise to be able to get blood from children. And in my opinion, only experienced staff should collect blood from a child. Children have a lower total blood volume than adults do. So the younger and smaller the child, the lower the volume that can be safely withdrawn from the child. This is especially important to consider if a child is in an intensive care unit or in a case where they've been sick for a prolonged amount of time and they've had to have a lot of blood drawn, a lot of tests done. So infants and children should not have more than 5% of their blood volume removed within a 24-hour period unless it is medically necessary. Removal of 3% or less is the preferred maximum. So for example, a 150-pound adult has about 5 liters of blood, so a 10-mL sample represents about 0.2% of the total volume of blood. In contrast, that same sample, so 10 mils of blood from a one-year-old represents 1% of their total blood volume. And in a newborn, it could be 3% of their total blood volume. So something to really keep in mind when you're doing multiple blood draws on pediatric patients. So a dermal puncture requires a very small amount of blood and is the most common pediatric collection procedure. However, it cannot be used when a larger volume of blood is required, such as for blood cultures or cross-match testing or for coagulation testing. For blood culture in infants and small children, a sample of 1 to 5 mL is required. And these blood culture bottles listed, this one right here is a pediatric one. So every brand has a pediatric one where that requires less blood than you would for an adult. For an adult, you want to use 10 mils per bottle. So that would be too much for an infant. So children also differ in their levels of understanding, their ability to cooperate, and their anxiety about medical procedures. So for many children, needles represent pain, and their fear of pain often makes a collection procedure challenging for the phlebotomist because they're going to be crying and screaming and trying to get away from you. So as your phlebotomist, your goal is to make the collection as calm, comfortable, and painless as possible for the child. Prolonged crying of the child can affect the test results. You need to prepare all your equipment ahead of time before the child even sees you, before you enter even into the room. And be friendly, cheerful, empathetic, and explain what you will be doing in terms of what that are appropriate for the child's age. If that child is just a year old, they're just not going to understand or two. So you just have to kind of use your judgment there. Often when they're little and they're just really not able to understand what's going on, it's better to have everything ready, have a helper with you, and then come in, talk to the parents, explain, see what's going to, let them know what's going to happen, and then proceed with the procedure as quickly and efficiently as you can, but yet remaining calm for the child. It is best to just get it quickly over with than to prolong their anxiety and their suffering. So don't tell a child that it will not hurt. Don't be lying to them, okay? But try to give the child voices whenever possible to increase his or her feeling of control. Like they can pick a fun Band-Aid if you have several types of Band-Aid afterwards. That you might even possibly let them pick which arm if that's possible, or which, if you're going to do dermal puncture, which hand you're gonna use. Use the shortest possible needle for the procedure. Keep it out of sight for as long as possible. Distract the child just before the actual stick so that he or she is looking away. Parents can be really helpful there. And during the draw, tell the child how much longer it will be. Just one more tube, just a few more seconds. Afterward, praise the child, even if he or she did not cooperate as well as you had hoped, and offer him or her a small reward, such as a sticker for younger children, or a pencil or something fun for older children. So parents who are present during the procedure can help in several ways. Parents with siblings can help distract and comfort the child. You can ask a parent whether the child has had blood drawn previously, and if so, what techniques help ease the child's anxiety. Some parents may prefer not to remain with the child during this procedure because they are reluctant to see the child in pain or become queasy at the sight of blood. In some cases, parents can make the child more anxious through their words or reactions, so it's usually better for them to not be in the room. So if you feel like the parents cannot help the child, or worse, can make things worse, you can politely suggest that they might be more comfortable waiting outside. Whether or not they will comply with your request, that just depends on the parent. For newborns, there can be some identification issues. So on their ID bracelets, newborns can be identified on their last names only. So it's usually baby boy or baby girl Smith, and or whatever their last name is. The ID band is often not on the arm. It can be on the leg. Sometimes there's one on the arm, one on the leg, but and sometimes they kick them off. So sometimes it could be like in the bassinet. So as always, you should use the hospital ID number, not the name, as the ultimate proof of ID. When performing a venipuncture, use the shorter needles if possible and use the smallest gauge consistent with the requirements of the test. So it's usually going to be a 23 gauge needle. Butterfly needles are smaller. You can use partial field tubes for pediatric draws. You want to keep your equipment out of the patient's reach, so kids can grab stuff. They can also throw stuff. They can grab stuff, stick it in their mouth. You want to take along a selection of rewards, such as stickers or small toys. Sometimes a topical anesthetic cream can be useful for venipuncture procedure in pediatric patients. The most commonly used agent is EMLA, is eutectic mixture of local anesthetics. So it's a mixture of lidocaine and prilocaine. But anesthetic is not recommended for PKU testing, which is usually done by a heel stick. Immobilization. So sometimes it's helpful to immobilize them because they're extremely wiggly and they're really not still and they're trying to get away from you. And for their own safety and yours, it's best to immobilize a pediatric patient. So wrapping newborns or very young infants in a receiving blanket is usually sufficient. So they're usually not strong enough to work themselves loose during the procedure. I'm going to show you how you can wrap them, but older babies, toddlers, and young children may need to be restrained, and you can actually use blankets for that also. You have to be careful, you don't want to suffocate a child, but it's often, you can also often wrap them in the same manner as you would wrap a newborn, like kind of burrito wrap them, and just have whatever arm that you're going to use for the procedure out of the wrap and everything else tucked in and tightly, securely wrapped. So pediatric draws can also be done with a patient either seated on the lap of a parent or another assistant or lying down on a gurney or bed with a parent or assistant, leaning over the child on the opposite side of where you're going to be working and distracting the child as much as possible. So for a seated child, a parent wants to hug the child's body, crosses his or her legs around the child's legs to prevent kicking, and holds arm not being used in the draw, so like wraps their arm and like holds that arm still. And then usually the helper of the phlebotomist will hold the other arm. For a child lying down, the parent or assistant can lean over the child holding the unused arm securely. For the helper that's going to help do the phlebotomy, you want to make sure you put pressure here underneath the elbow so they can't bend their elbow by putting the flat of your hand on the elbow, and then you want to grab the wrist nice and tight and pull on it too so that you can get a nice straight arm. So here shown with a little newborn, you can just kind of fold a blanket, wrap them, so you're going to tuck the one arm that you're not using in and leave the arm that you are going to use out. And then wrap them nice and snug and tight, like a little cocoon with just the one arm out. So let's talk about neonatal bilirubin. So bilirubin is a substance that's produced by the normal breakdown of red cells. The liver is responsible for processing the bilirubin, so it does not reach excessive levels in the blood. So Buildup of the bilirubin in the blood can cause jaundice or a yellowing of the skin, and it can lead to brain damage if left untreated. That is a condition that's called kernicterus. Bilirubin is light sensitive, and so you have to be mindful of that when you collect the specimen. So the specimens are usually collected in these amber-colored tubes that block light with the yellow top. And if not, they need to be wrapped in paper or in foil or something to block the light. Hemolysis of the specimen can falsely lower the results, and so you have to be careful not to hemolyze the specimen. And you want to record the collection time exactly so that the accurate rate of the bilirubin increase or decrease can be recorded. And that can guide therapy for the newborn. Therapy for excess bilirubin is often exposure to ultraviolet lights, sunlight also, but they have little treatments, little billy lights that they can use to help lower the bilirubin, because light helps break down the bilirubin that is in the skin and helps to make it water soluble where the baby can clear it through kidneys. Also, we can do neonatal screening. So they are required as part of the mandatory state-based public health programs. The tests are used to detect inherited metabolic disorders that can cause severe brain damage or other impairments and allow for the implementation of early intervention treatments for the health of the child. The blood for neonatal screening is collected by capillary heel stick on a special filter paper, usually while they're in the hospital, so as newborns. Recent studies have shown that the levels of phenylalanine are significantly different between capillary and venous samples, so if it requires capillary, you need to use capillary samples. The filter paper is supplied in a kit that's provided by the state agency that's responsible for the screening test, and when you use the paper, you do not touch or contaminate the area inside the circles because that can alter the results. This is what one of them from our state agency looks like. It has to be completely filled out, and every circle here needs to be filled to the borders, and the blood needs to be seen on the other side of the filter, so it needs to soak all the way through, and then this part can be folded over to protect it. So to collect a neonatal screening specimen, you first are going to do a routine heel stick. You're going to wipe away the first drop of blood and then apply one large drop of blood directly to the circle. You do not want to touch the paper against the puncture site. You do not want to apply successive drops on a single circle. The drop must be evenly spread. Although applied to only one side of the filter paper, the blood should be visible from both sides. You want to air dry the specimen on a dry, clean, flat, horizontal, non-absorbent surface for a minimum of 3 hours. You want to keep it at room temperature and away from direct sunlight until it is delivered to the laboratory, and you do want to deliver it pretty promptly to the laboratory so it can be sent to the state laboratory. So what can cause specimen rejection for neonatal screenings? The use of expired specimen collection cards, the collection date that's missing, the quantity is not sufficient on the circles of the paper, the blood was not completely soaked through the filter paper, you have contaminated or discolored specimen, blood is either cake, clotted, or layered on the filter paper circles, the patient demographic information is missing, the form number does not match that of the blood circles, the specimen is too old on the receipt, on receipt, so it was received 14 or more days after the collection, so there was a delay in getting it there or get misplaced or something, or, you know, didn't get sent in the right time frame. The requisition form is received, but there's not a blood sample with it. This specimen submitted on an improper collection form. There's an improper drying or collection that results in serum separation. The specimen is torn or damaged during transit, or there was a lab accident, which sometimes can mean they lost it or something happened and it wasn't processed properly. All right, that wraps up our pediatric concerns, and next we're going to be our geriatric concerns.